buddy.
Yo, guess who went to the emergency room with a fresh new hand injury? What?
Huh?
I slammed my hand down. I had a sledgehammer, and I was hitting a thing, and I hit real hard and split my knuckle open. And I thought, I bet that doesn't need stitches. Please don't let it need stitches. And so I wound it up real good and went to bed. And then the next morning I looked and I was like, okay, let's undo this. Yeah, that looks fine. Here, let me make a fist. Oh, I'm bleeding everywhere. That probably should have had stitches. So let me go to the ER. And they were like, yeah, you probably should have gotten stitches, but just point for a week and you'll be fine.
So we're just going to skip to the end and get you a hook?
Here's the thing.
I mean, like, at this point, you've proven to be irresponsible with it. Let's just go ahead and skip right to the hook.
The weird part is every time I have a hand injury, Jason Murphy's career skyrockets upwards. So
I have that relationship with my friend Ken Montgomery.
Yeah.
Every time something good happens to me, something bad happens to him. Like, I get a cruise ship job, he loses his job.
I get
a TV show, he gets a divorce.
We're pretty sure at some point I'm going to get a phone call and Jason says, hey, listen, I'm up for this thing. I'm going to need a pinky, man. I'm sorry.
There's dude, the weird just... friend simpatico.
Yeah.
Hey, what happened with the old, with the Murph?
He got a thing optioned for another thing, which is pretty cool. Yeah. But that happened like within minutes of me messing up my hand.
Blood
and,
sacrifice,
that's right,
man.
It was like almost immediately after
right.
that he got that phone call.
Well, and the thing I'm most thankful for is that Bonnie just happened to show up at that moment so she could see, like, there's no coming home and just telling Bonnie. No, it was not. I was not being irresponsible. I was just using a sledgehammer to slam a thing, and I did it wrong. Like, she was so glad that she was there in the room as well, because otherwise she's like, I would have been pissed. I would have been so mad.
Oops, I should be fixed now. Thank you for reminding me.
But also, I went to the ER kind of partly because...
You wanted to say hello to your friends because
the gang. partly because I was thinking about going and just getting a. As Justin and I were talking about, I wanted to know if I was doing the right things on the scar management from the drone thing, and it was on my list of like, yeah, I'll get around to booking an appointment, and I kind of got a 2-for-1. I got a, this will be fine, and hey, doing pretty good on that.
As long as you do anything on camera or use your hands, you're fine.
Yeah. I'm gonna be like M. Bison and just all or no, not M. Bison. M. Bison was the original name of Sagat. I'll be Sagat and always have taped hands.
Come on. Just right to hook. Or iron hand. Like,
I mean, that'd be really roguish.
That would be. Oh, like shit. Style.
A real Jamie Lannister.
You want to be the best rogue? Have a hook for a hand. Modern rogue.
New song.
do the robot voice that Brant like.
Yeah.
Modern rogue.
Brian gets a hook.
Brian gets a hook.
That's a catchy hook.
LOL, get it?
Because I'm a modern rogue. All right, I am going to tell...
I love that new intro. That new intro is great.
Oh, yeah? Cool.
Yeah, the big massive zoom out.
Yeah, that was a wild day, man.
Yeah.
It stayed foggy and mysterious all day long. It was misty moors. I was quietly getting sick and didn't know it. I faced down the same drone that took my right hand.
Okay.
Also, by the way, in the Twitch dashboard... Mm-hmm.
No, we
amongst
got
the all the titles and everything. We now own the Diamond Club community.
Oh, we are owners.
We've been using that the past couple days.
Yeah. Nice.
Literally, you own the community. It's this weird new internet law.
That's right.
I made it because I timed it perfect.
Well done, sir.
I sniffed out by myself when Communities was launching.
So it's like Communities basically teams for the public teams?
Hello, Remix Rob.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
We'll go use that if you're on the Twitch. Alrighty, I think I'm good over here, gentlemen.
Turns out the Podcast Awards owns the Diamond Group community. Mm-hmm. They just say,
Diamond Group hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Ha 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 ha.
Brought to you by listeners like you. There was this old New Yorker cartoon, and it was like, PBS is brought to you by listeners by you. And it was a photo of this like guy like in a, maybe it was a Playboy cartoon, I don't know, but like a guy in a... a clown suit, probably like with a sheep next to him.
Oh, that's amazing. It's
pretty much one or the other, you know.
There was
probably was a Playboy cartoon, now that I think about it.
There was a great meme, I think it was one of the Trump tweets that was like I make all my decisions based on facts or whatever, that they just found out that if you put it under literally any New Yorker cartoon, it just totally fits. It's just, you know, every random New Yorker cartoon, like, you know, a dog driving or, you know, a.
All righty, guys. We want to weird things.
Ready on your mark.
All right. Well, let's go in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hey, gang, what's going on?
And Brian, soon to be Lefty Brushwood.
hey, man, you're talking as though I had another hand injury that sent me to the ER. That'd be cuckoo banana pants. And that's not true, except for it's totally true.
Yeah, for those of you keeping track, Brian had Brian versus the drone.
I was the victim of a drone strike, which, by the way,
I got the propeller on the back of the hand, though.
Reminder, I'm holding a quadcopter from underneath, and I'm holding it like a chalice. So if you're at playing the home game, turn your right hand palm up as if you're holding a bowl, and then picture to the left and right are blades that are out off to the sides, but then it kind of swoops in. So it hits both sides at once. It goes one side slicing the back of my hand, the other side just shaving off most of my thumb.
Oh, jeez.
It's fine. I'm going to grow back even stronger. That's the way it works.
So Brian switched to non-sentient devices.
Yeah, okay.
Self-inflicted.
All right, this time I was using a sledgehammer. Safety. I was using a sledgehammer, a 5-pound sledgehammer, and I slammed down so hard that my knuckle, I basically did the equivalent of just making a fist and punching as hard as I could on some hard surface wood, and it split my knuckle. And I looked at it, and I refused to. I was like, I am not going to get more stitches. This is bogus.
Modern medicine's bunk.
I'm sure it's fine. Look at it. It's fine. It's finally stopped bleeding. As long as I'm pointing, it doesn't bleed. And so then I pointed all night as I slept.
You were number one.
I was number one in my dreams. And then I woke up, and I'm like, and I unwrapped it, and I'm like, see, it looks great as long as I'm pointing. And then I curled my hand, and then just blood started going. I was like, I should go to the ER. And then and I went to the ER, and they are like, well, it's not infected. Probably should have gotten stitches on that last night. And I'm like, well, what do I do? And they're like, for the next week, point.
And you paid for this.
And so that's what I'm doing. I'm just pointing. I'm making a lot of you're gonna see a lot of this, me wagging my finger in the air as I pontificate.
You're gonna do like Dikembe Mutombo people, and you know, there's just gonna be a lot of one digit solutions.
So here's the thing to think about. This wasn't really going to be a topic, but it's sort of an interest, and it sort of relates to this. They've experts. I love the experts, because we don't have to call them scientists or researchers. 38,000 years ago, in somewhere in France, southern France, someone carved an image of a wild grouse surrounded by rows of dots in a slab of limestone. Right.
I'm sorry. Real quick, that almost sounded like English to me.
I'm so sorry. I've got
a wild corral.
I'll say this again more slowly. 38,000 years ago, someone in southern France carved the image of a wild cow surrounded by rows of dots in a slab of limestone.
Got it. Okay.
For a second, it sounded like it was a wild person from Germany.
It could be. It could be. I woke up yesterday and my voice was so deep it freaked me out. I literally was like, I'm like, because I talk to myself sometimes because I'm not crazy. And I'm like, well, Andrew, what do you do now? I'm like, that's creeping me out that like, because my voice was even deeper than this. And I'm like, that's just, it's like there's a weird creepy guy standing in the corner going, okay, Andrew, now what are you going
to
do?
Real quick, time out. Do you guys have conversations with yourselves like to get motivated? Where I will do that. I'll speak out loud. I'm like, all right, buddy, look, we're either going to do this or not. You know, when I know nobody's around, I'll be all like, come on, look, I'm going to, we'll do this. We'll just power through that. And then I'm going to let you have a beer. Who likes a beer? Come on, buddy, let's do this. All right, look at you. You're doing it. The pants are on. You're jogging. All right. Hey, who's working out? Good job.
I have a theory, Brian, and I'm afraid to admit that you and I are probably the only two on the podcast that do this. And Justin's probably looking at us like we're crazy people.
So you do the same thing.
Oh no. I'll go one better. I argue with myself. Like I'll go both voices. Like, so you're just talking to yourself, imagining that you're your own thing. I will actually argue with, like, well, I don't know, should I do this? Well, on one side you gotta do this.
Out loud?
I don't think so. Not so fast.
Do you do this out loud?
I will physically talk on both sides.
So I don't argue with myself out loud. I do verbally express disapproval as things are happening. where it's like, potato chips, huh? You're just gonna eat those potato chips. Just like it's totally healthy. Like you're not trying to lose weight or nothing.
Your problem. Next time, come back at yourself with your smug judgment. Like, you know, like, F you, I deserve it.
Yeah, fair enough. Fair enough.
There was a study years ago, and I don't know if this has been backed up or whatever. It made a lot of sense. And what they did is they took schizophrenics, people with like severe schizophrenia, and they would take a microphone and they'd put it on a time delay, their own voice, like 4 or 5 seconds, and feed it back to them, right?
Yeah.
And they'd be like, okay, what do I do now? And they'd hear a little later, okay, what do I do now? And they're like, who said that? There was a complete disconnect from their speech center and their recognition center. They didn't understand that they were the person speaking, and that's one of the theories of one of the forms of schizophrenia. Here we have. Jesus, Bryce, you're amazing. He already has the Stroop effect. Is this it?
I think so. This is
conflict between irrelevant words and relevant colors. Oh, the Stroop test is the one where it's difficult to read or to say the color of a word when you want to read what the word says instead.
Yeah, so what this implies is that where most of us have this ability to know that it's our inner voice with schizophrenics, they're hearing this inner voice and they don't recognize it as coming from themselves. And I mean, it's just a fascinating thing. It's like I had that experience yesterday when I woke up and my voice was I hadn't had that happen in years where it was just that deep and that different. And when I started talking out loud, you know, everybody on here does, so it's not weird. It was a weird thing. I'm like, okay, Andrew, now what are you going to do? It's like, Max Maven, where are you? And it was just a weird sort of sensation because it felt strange.
Are you comfortable with the idea? And we've talked about, you know, there are problems with it. The book Incognito postulates that, you know, there are people who, and we've talked about this before, who have had a hemispherectomy as a child. They had seizures so bad that they removed half of the brain, and these people go on to live perfectly fine lives with just half a brain. And the comparison they make is that your brain is basically Congress. You have a right hemisphere and a left hemisphere, and it's technically possible for lightning to strike all of the Democrats or all the Republicans and for the government to function. Now, what the government does will look very, very different based on it's one or the other, but it can function, and it's the same way with our brains. And it's only when both sides kind of agree on an action that we take it, and then we have, as you know, this metaphor of the child king who thinks he's in charge, is this illusion of would that be the ego or the id or the perceived self?
Well, that's, ego would sort of the id, sort of the desire, the ego is the sense of self.
There you go. So I guess the ego. But at any rate, like ever since I've read that, I've noticed times that, you know, when you talk to yourself, it's not as crazy as you think. You are a consensus. You exist as a series of actions that result as a bunch of electrical modules all come to an agreement
I was at a party Saturday night, and there were two people talking, and talking about moving or going somewhere, like in some location where they're living. Part of me knew they were talking about Vancouver, but part of me wanted to talk about Los Angeles. And so I was talking about Los Angeles, and part of me is like aware of like, no, this is about Vancouver. And afterwards, I'm like, I think they were looking at me funny because I knew they were talking. I didn't catch the first part, but I know they both worked in Vancouver. And I was like, you know, it was this weird sort of like, I've had that happen before where like I watch myself say something. I'm like, that's not really what I want to say. You know, that's not what I should be saying. But some other part of me is sort of like, overruled. We're going to have this conversation instead.
Yeah, well, so much of this I'm sure we've talked about at some point, but my favorite are those brain studies on split brain patients where they feed an action message to the it's the left hemisphere that has language in it, right? Or is it the right hemisphere? Which one has Broca's area, the area where we form language?
I want to say left, but.
Okay, but whatever it is, they fed an action like stand up and walk towards the door by feeding it to just one eye, which means it went to only one side of the brain, and the corpus callosum was gone, so that it didn't share it with the other side of the brain. And then somebody reads, you know, they're told to follow instructions. They read stand up and walk towards the door, and so they do it, and then they say, hey, why are you doing that? And then the language part of the brain, not knowing why, because it didn't have that information, immediately rationalizes it, saying, oh, I was just going to get a Coke. You want a Coke? And then maybe the command is laugh. And it's like, and then they'd laugh. And it's like, why are you laughing? And it's like, you know, you eggheads and the science stuff. It's just crazy. It's just crazy.
I wonder, you know, I read some of those studies, and I wonder a lot of these people, they're sort of kind of the advanced sort of stages, often dealing with some sort of, you know, either some sort of brain issue, dementia, things like this, where this do that. And I wonder how much of that people who go through those sort of conditions are sort of conditioned to respond in certain ways. And also, like, I'm curious to know, like, I have no reason to doubt it, but I'm curious to know, like what are the confidence when they give those answers and stuff? Because one of the things that I think the three of us do and a lot of our listeners deal with is the whole concept of uncertainty and the idea that to really be a skeptic and open-minded, you have to abandon the concept of personal certainty. You have to accept probability.
Right. You have to sit there cozied up with the misery of mystery right next to you, of the superposition, knowing it could be one thing or the other and knowing you'll never really find out which one.
Yeah. I mean, we could all be in the Matrix, you know. That all of our memories, like, you know, I try to explain to people, like, imagine if, like, there was no such thing, there really was no such thing as airplanes until this morning, and some mad scientist implanted this idea in all of our heads, you know, and we fundamentally can't accept that because we have all these personal memories, all these, you know, understanding and deep, deep memories about airplanes, things about this idea. But if you had a video game character to do the same thing to it, you know, and it was highly detailed enough, it would feel the same way.
Yeah.
And it's hard because like I can't conceive that it could be a implanted memory, but I accept the idea that it could be.
Did I ever tell you guys about the time I discovered time travel and I made the horrible decision to travel?
Why didn't you tell it, Brian?
So
yeah, no, you didn't. Thanks.
Yeah.
When I think I've told this story before, but when I was in sixth grade, I realized, okay, I'm going to time travel to 10 seconds in the future. And when I land there, my brain is going to fill in all the memories of that 10 seconds. So, but I'll be there. And I did it. And I spent 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I'm like, okay, what is the difference between me saying that and me actually having done that? Because maybe I said it and I just moved through time in real time, or maybe I actually cast that spell and I did teleport 10 seconds in the future with all my memories of the time inside. What is the functional difference? And then I was just like, I'm going to time travel to 90 years old and I'm going to remember this moment and I'm going to suddenly just have a lifetime full of memories. And I haven't gotten there yet, but when I do, I will remember that moment and I will think, son of a bitch. I mean, who's to say it didn't work?
Brian's 90th birthday, they bring the cake and the candles out. He's like, I did it! I did it! Oh, wait, I'm old. This sucks.
Yeah.
And why do I have hooks on my hands?
Isn't that the plot of Click? Did you invent the Adam Sandler movie Click and are going to be very sad in about 70?
No, Click was just a retelling of A Christmas Carol. That was a different thing.
Yeah, totally different price. Well, gentlemen, you know, in order to make Brian's time travel. What's that?
What about that mad cow out there in France?
Wait, there's a mad cow?
Oh, that was just the 38,000-year-old inscription they found. I don't know if there was anything, you know, old. Oh. Something old. So what I was going to get to is Brian Stitches. Who was the first person, like here we – imagine us, like, 15,000 years ago. Our buddy Brian, you know, Bri-Bri, as we called him back then. Bri-Bri is clubbed himself, you know, with his rock, you know, his hand axe again. And we're looking at this gaping wound. Justin, who's going to have the idea of, like, hey, you know that bone needle thing we use to make the pieces of leather stick together? That was the great idea we took from the women folk. Who had the idea of looking at Brian's gaping wound and, like, you know, maybe we could sew that up?
You know, I would guess it's probably some it's got to, like, come from some, like, manipulation of dead animals, right? Like, just some understanding of flesh and, like, our flesh, like their flesh, sew it together so it heals better.
Well, yeah, I'm sure, like, we imagine they had sewing first, you know, that they were sewing, you know, clothes and stuff. And then Brian's got this cut. Like, Brian, Justin, JoJo and I have been talking, and we have an idea.
Bri-Bri, Bri-Bri in pain. Bri-Bri, just point for a week. It's fine. It's fine.
Bri-Bri, points. It's called a clinical study.
I would imagine
we peed on our hands, so it's the cleanest substance we have.
I would imagine that this is the role of the shaman. You know, anthropologically, that's one of the structures we see all the time. Is you know, the spiritual leader, the person who sees what other people don't see. They notice patterns of, you know, the moon and so on. They do weird stuff like eating and weird rituals, and some of them work and some of them don't work, but. It seems like structurally we give permission to the weird ones to try something when we as a tribe don't know what to do, right?
Yeah, I wonder, like, but I don't think, I mean, like, when I hear shaman now, all I think is ancient weed dealer.
Like, I mean, that's racist of you to say, but the, but on top of that, they were also the ones, you know, while everyone else was worried about planting the seeds or whatever, they're the ones looking at the moon and noticing the celestial movement and so on.
Okay,
and,
all right, Bri-Bri. No,
they're the ones that were like, hey, man, if I just say that I'm time traveling 10 seconds, I have all the memories, like, what's the difference, right?
Are you saying that I was meant to be a shaman?
I'm a shaman, man. What's up?
Like, hey, man, listen. I have this idea about that gaping wound. You know, we were over in our hut working on some new spells with some herbs we got from the river tribe. And we have an idea we want to try. It's actually not so herbal as a treatment. It's more of a practical one.
Bri-Bri concerned, but losing lots of blood. Explain idea.
Okay, so we get Bon Bon.
Oh, wait,
the
first, let me get this bongo beat going.
Yes. Okay. So you like your pants? You like your pants? You like them?
Yes, pants fit very tight, too tight these days. Ha ha ha! Losing blood.
And you know how
Bri-Bri
they fit together the seams, because we get women folk to go sew those together. Oh, men were sewing too, like an Otzi the caveman. He probably sewed his, you know, Otzi the Iceman. He probably sewed his clothes. But anyhow, it's like, you know how they fit together nicely.
Yes. Unlike my hand, split
all
asunder.
All your hand is basically, it's not leather yet. It's skin. It's just not leather. I mean, it's almost it's proto leather, and we could sew it. We could take that thread and sew it together.
So I would assume that it happens in that situation where,
and then wear it as our own clothing.
Here's my question: the first time it happened, like with the intention of let's stitch this together because it's open and that's bad, and we're, you know, we know that when we see a jagged slash like that, that's bad. Do you think the person was awake, or maybe somebody took a tumble and they're all like, well, this person's out. Maybe he wakes up, maybe he doesn't. I know for sure that can't look like that. And so somebody just wallies out, just sews it up.
Like, I mean, maybe it was like some psychopath in the village sees this corpse, this guy, this half dead guy with his gaping wounds, is like, yeah, I'm going to sew us back together. You know, And the guy's like, oh, thanks. It's like,
No, we were doing that for medicine. By the way, we invented medicine. Yeah, also, like, have you ever looked at the stars, man?
Is he a great big guy? It's Buffalo Bill.
Yeah.
I mean, like, where does that stop, though, right? Because if on one hand you're like, oh, like, in the same way that we treat the animal pelts, we will sew your hand together. Like, isn't that really just the gateway to, like, hey, when you're dead, though, can I wear your flesh?
You know, waste not, want not.
Well, I mean, and there's a little bit of that in the, I mean, sorry. You've heard the theory that that the wife-swapping culture among test pilots was effectively a coping mechanism for the fact that everyone knew that at any moment they'd get into a rocket and just explode or whatever, and that they would want somebody to take care of their family and kids. And so by kind of, you know, mixing it up with other people's wives, they knew that, well, if I'm not there, I know old Joe will take care of her like he did Thursday night. Have you heard that?
Maybe. Also, it's such a high testosterone culture, too. But yeah, those pragmatic sort of emergences of things like that are fascinating. And thinking of support.
We get to there from primitive people asking to wear each other's flesh.
Yeah, yes, also bleeding much. Explain idea fast.
Also, can I bang your wife now? Like, I mean, is that like the opening? Is that like the art of the deal? Like, hey, can I wear your skin when you're dead? No? All right, then can I just bang your wife one time right now?
There has to be like artists who have bequeathed their skin to like bind books and stuff, right? In the modern era?
Oh, I'm sure there's probably a whole library of, like, you know, Swedish death metal people that, you know, are all bound up.
What's legal and not legal to insist people do with your body after you're dead? Because like it's tough to a friend of mine's mom had breast cancer and their breast was removed and she tried really hard to get it because she wanted to bronze it and she thought that would be funny. And they're like, no, we're not going to hand you biohazard waste from your own flesh. That's not happening. And but I'm betting somewhere along the line, you know, I know some people have their own bones and stuff.
Yeah, they like some stuff. I think there are state laws as far as how you're supposed to handle certain kinds of, you know, biomedical waste, and their issues as far as that was one of the things that came out too, is they found out like there's like useful medical material in corpses, and there's been issues where funeral homes and stuff that like you would think that, you know, like this guy's been dead for several days, what's good there, but stuff they've actually been able to harvest and things like that are useful for medical stuff. And that's been an issue sometimes where they find out that, like, you know, before grandpa goes into the ground, you know, they kind of had a little salvage sale,
little free-for-all. I mean, turns out there's some good plasma. Oh, by the way, you guys know that anyone who is quote-unquote donating plasma is selling that, like, no, if you're getting paid for any biological stuff, I mean, you know what, I would love an expert to correct me on this, but at some point I was told, if you're getting paid, it's not being used for medical purposes. If you are donating plasma and getting a check for it, that plasma is being used in cosmetics, and that is being used in commercial products.
Yeah, because you're not, like, for medical stuff, you're not supposed to sell things.
Right. Like, nobody's oh, little Johnny just needs a little plasma. If only somebody had gotten $50 for donating some last week. Oh, he did. That doesn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah, there's like the laws on that are interesting, because there's some people say, like, well, maybe you should let people sell certain things. Well, you can sell like eggs and stuff. So
yeah, right.
But that's not
but
like
I guess that's, but I guess that's like it's like a private like brokerage like that.
Well, but
stuff.
It's also not an organ. You know, it's not. And I don't want the laws. You can't sell blood.
I mean, you could. I would assume eggs fall into that category of things that are routinely discharged. So, like I assume I could sell you a bottle of pee. I could sell you a bottle of poop. Whereas, like,
I'll tell you something else you can sell.
Your hair.
Pride, which is what we are doing when we bring up that patreon.com/.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I typed in, wait, can I sell blood? And, Bryce, see if you get the first thing you get.
What? Thank you, Google.
You can earn $13,000 a year selling your poop.
You can from the Washington Post. You could donate blood, plasma, eggs, and sperm.
Wait, let's go back to that first line.
Yeah, hold on. Wait a minute.
Well, you know about this whole fecal transplant.
Yeah, I know, but I didn't know that I was flushing away a fortune.
Yeah, $13K a year, man. That's nothing to sneeze at.
Yeah, well, and right now...
You're literally sitting on a gold mine.
Yeah, you almost said the word right. But on a gold buy.
So here's the catch is you have to be incredibly healthy. Quote, it's harder to become a donor than it is to get into MIT, joked co-founder Mark Smith. Of the 1,000 or so potential donors who have expressed interest, only about 4% have passed the extensive medical questioning and stool test.
Yeah.
Well, there goes that dream.
Haves and have nots.
Okay, question.
Yeah.
Real quick, let's do the Patreon plug.
Patreon.com/weirdthings is where you can support the show. Thank you guys so much for continuing to make this show happen. We are up over 500 an episode and still five away from 420 patrons. If you want to go ahead and do it, then you better get on it right now. That is patreon.com/weirdthings. And we thank everybody who supports us.
So we talked about the idea that the brain that what we think of is the us, the ego, the self identity is a conglomeration of different modules that agree from time to time. On the flip side, our body is super affected by the type of biome living in our colons or whatever. I actually don't know the specifics, but what is it, like 5 pounds of bacteria that we have in us or something ridiculous?
Mm-hmm.
And it affects everything. Like that bacteria essentially becomes an external organ. On top of that, you got all these rich people who have figured out that if you take a young person's blood and inject it into you, there's a bunch of ill-defined benefits of energy and youth and recovery or whatever, like literal vampirism.
Yeah, that this data on that is still developing, and it may not be that so much that young blood's good for you as much as old blood's bad for you, kind of thing. But same difference in some ways. And so, yeah, that's been we've talked about that before, about the whole idea of Brian secretly tapping his children's blood.
Yes, that's right. So the question is, is there an upper limit of replacement parts to you that you would do? We replace, let's say right now, for the most part, we tend to replace joints only when they break and are no good. But there are some procedures, for example, pitchers in Major League Baseball will get certain procedures done just so that they can whip the ball better. Is there an upper limit? Would you just go straight cyborg if we were going to define that line of that's too weird. Filling my body with machine built blood and replacing my gut fauna with the poop of somebody healthier than me and swapping out my bones. And at what point do you stop? At what point do you stop being you? And do you care?
I love the idea of kind of the sort of the gradualist sort of argument, because the slowest cells in our body to replace are brain cells. Alongside, we'd even think that we grew, new brain cells develop, but now we know what they do, but it's a much slower rate. But that kind of explains that there's some sort of permanence there. But I'd pose this argument that is, what if tonight I replaced randomly, 1% of the cells in your brain with exact copies, right? You wake up tomorrow, you're still you, right? And we do that 100, we have to do that, 100 days in a row until I've replaced you.
Right.
At what point do you go, I'm not me?
On top of that, but then again, I look at me from, 20 years ago, I'm like, I'm already not that guy. That's already some, echo of a person that was the proto version of who I am now.
So I think if it's gradual, I don't know that there would be a limit for me. I think that we've all sort of, we have people who are stuck with this whole nature good, man bad sort of arguments, who still like to enjoy a lot of the many unnatural sort of technological advancements from, vaccinations to other things. And they draw these very arbitrary lines that I feel are arbitrary and continuously, you know, shift and change. And, you know, you'll the person that tries to go for the natural remedies and all that, when they realize that that's not going to work, are going to start embracing other stuff. You know, we, you know, from filling, you know, starts with, if you have a cavity, you got to put something in there, you know, and you put a filling in there.
Right.
And you're already
we don't hear a lot of people with tooth abscesses insisting that it's unnatural to fill it with ceramic. Yep.
We'll complain about, oh, well, there's the, you know, there's the lead in there, the mercury inside the fillings and stuff, which probably has never affected a single person in the 21st century. But, you know, we replaced, you know, but like, yeah, as a precautionary measure, we replace those. But yeah, I mean, for the most part, yeah, people will complain about stuff. They'll complain about the things that are easy. They feel that they have a choice about. But then when you don't or whatever, we change our opinions on that, you know. And so, like, yeah, like, you know, we don't complain about fillings, stitches. You know, stitches aren't it's not a natural healing process. There's show me an animal that stitches.
I guess it just does.
Yeah. So I guess, and that's, you know, I think, so what it comes down to is that, like, I think we're almost all gradualists. You know, I think it's just the rate at which we're willing to adopt these changes is different.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's two sides of it. There's whether or not we adapt to it and we want to accept it as a viable method. And then there's kind of what we have now, which is sort of the luxury of health. And that, like, we can, like, oh, well, considering we live in a society where this plague does not directly affect us, I don't know, but maybe we don't get vaccinated. You know, how about that? How about we just go ahead and play with house money a little bit?
Yeah, because you're resting on the capital of everybody else, the health capital of all the other people who have, but then you're affecting the whole idea of, you know, herd immunity. You know, and you know, we talk about, like, you know, aspirin. You know, you take an aspirin or whatever. You take this. That's not it's natural. Like, no, it's not. I mean, it's yes, it's a naturally occurring. Well, aspirin is a refined sort of substance. Or even a lot of these remedies people have. Oh, it's a natural remedy. Like, no, it's a highly concentrated version of something that doesn't exist in that form in nature. But even then, the idea of eat this, do that, like, you know, we had to do a lot of experimentation stuff to find these things to take. And so that's, to me, that's augmentation. And, you know, it's funny that, you know, I know some of the people who are the most vocal about some of this augmentation stuff are very fine with chemical enhancements and stuff. And, like, you know, really radically altering the brain chemistry with things that you could not do with purely natural substances.
But then again, I mean, how different is any of this from the idea of making the decision on January 1st that you want to be a person who is lighter, healthier, can run farther, and so on? And so instead of, you know, replacing your lungs with a higher capacity processing engine, you commit to a routine of, quote unquote, jogging for 3 to 5 miles every day for the next 6 months. And then you come out the other side a fundamentally altered person. And it was behavior altered instead of, you know, directly altered. I don't know that there's a moral decision. It culturally, it certainly seems like there's a moral distinction, but ethically, I can't see the difference between the two at all. Like,
no, I agree. I think for us, we just see the gradual sort of slope. And I think other people have these sort of arbitrary differences there. And not to say that we're right, you know, and I think that maybe there could be some clear differences. And when you start getting into, you know, things that are personality, we do a lot of chemical things now to alter our personalities, whether it's caffeine, alcohol, things like that, which are on a temporary basis. When you start getting into a permanent basis, you know, that might be a difference. But that's a thing we talk about, like, you know, the idea of brain pacemakers, which is a thing that's being developed further out. There's research money being going into the neural lace concept that we know from our Peter F. Hamilton books and that kind of thing, of the idea of this way to integrate your brain actually with digital and online technologies.
What is the reality of that at this moment? Because to me, I read all of that in Peter F. Hamilton's science fiction as, like, crazy far off one day thing. But like, where are we at physically now?
Well, the foremost public person on Neuralasis would probably be Elon Musk.
What? Who's this young buck?
August 30th inverse. Elon Musk is making progress on his Neuralace design.
Okay. And the benefit being that, Neuralace, if it's precise enough, it would be able to monitor and watch the neural interactions, as complicated as they are, and record them in some way for a direct neural interface?
So Elon Musk, part of the one of the research he's working at different research groups, including OpenAI, and their fear is the idea of artificial intelligence, the threat that artificial intelligence could pose towards humanity. And I would say that, you know, there are people like, oh, that's overstated, it's overstated. Well, it's overstated before it's understated. You know, yeah. That's the way threats work. There's always somebody going, man, not a problem, until, oh, wow, this is a problem. And to say that it's not a threat without any information is just, to me, irrational. So Elon Musk's biggest concern is that he's actually talked about recently about that, that we need to have this man-machine symbiosis, and the neural lace is a way to do that. It's this sort of integration between our brain and these systems, and he thinks that's the only way we'll be able to keep pace and sort of not get stomped on by hyper-intelligent AI. And so this is the thing that's very serious to him. This is the thing that, you know, when he tells his five kids bedtime stories.
I mean, I guess that's the only real solution to the looming threat of AI, is that at no point do we develop an AI that is completely divorced from humanity. Like, this idea of AI right now is outside going in. Like, we just create a robot mind and comes in. Truthfully, I think it's going to be inside out. It's going to be augmented us, and there's going to be less and less of the biology and more of the simulations running, until at some point that's going to be the quote unquote real person. I do think, as a parlor trick, there'll be a number of Turing machines that can pass the Turing test. But I think, as far as conscious, what we will recognize as conscious beings, it seems like it'll be inside out, not the other way around.
Well, but I remember the whole point of the Turing test was sort of a philosophical argument, is that if you can't tell the difference, then how do you know the people you're talking to are sentient? Just because you have sentience, you have no reason to assume that somebody else does.
Right.
You know, and that was sort of the point there, is it's not so much proof that something is sentient as much as proof that the argument for sentience is not as firmly entrenched as we might think it is, that our arguments for our own and other people, you know, Phil, you know, talking to you guys, I mean, maybe you have the same process inside my head. You answer all the questions right, but am I convinced? Not really. You ever read The Story by Harlan Ellison, I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream?
I'm familiar with the title and don't know anything else about it.
Yeah,
basically this master computer that sort of took over the world. There was a kind of a lawsuit between Harlan Ellison and James Cameron's production company over this, because of very, very similar to Terminator. I mean, this was written in 1966 or something. Anyhow, this supercomputer takes over, and it keeps a bunch of people around and basically just tortures them.
Oh, wow.
Jesus.
Yeah.
There's a video game based on this, I believe, a PC
yep.
game.
Yeah, it's yeah. an adventure game, and it's... I've seen a lot of playthroughs of it, actually. It's supposed to be pretty close to the story. There are a couple of character changes so that, you know, it could be a sellable video game to the public. But
yeah, no, Steam has it as 9 out of 10 rating, and Good Old Games has it at 4.4 out of 5. Yeah.
So that's what Elon Musk probably reads to his children at night.
Seems like a pretty jovial guy.
Badweave in the chat has a good point. It says, isn't that the basis of Portal? I have no doubt that there's connective, you know, artistic tissue between the two.
So the good news is that Google has been, and then researchers have been working with their own stuff, been working with DeepMind to basically what they wanted to do is they developed an AI network, their DeepMind AI system, and they said, let's have it play games against other systems and see how they interact. Mm-hmm. Turns out they said, okay, let's have this fruit gathering game where they're out there like just virtually trying to collect fruit. Are they going to cooperate? Are they going to fight? And the good news, if you're a nihilist, is they fight intensely with each other.
Ha! So wait a minute. How is the rules for success written? Is the rules made like the goal is to have the most fruit, or the goal is to have more fruit than the other guy, or the goal is
to gather as many virtual apples as you can.
And it figures out, oh, got it. I see.
But so like a the thing of... is, when there was scarcity, they fought. When there were plenty of apples to go around, there was less fighting.
Yeah. And at no point did they... So this is the weird part. Like, on the one hand, the correct solution, if these were, you know, we're watching foxes fight over chickens here. If we were watching men, very quickly the two of them would figure out how to fill the entire screen with apples. Or at least in theory. I mean, that's Julian Simon's, you know, philosophy is that human intelligence is the most precious of all resources.
Well, no, I agree. But I mean, like, more people died in the 20th century from people trying to manage resources and, you know, forced, you know, Mao killed 20 or 30, 30 or 40 million people.
Sure. But again, you know, my point is that there's no what we would like to see is the insight that you can change the rules of the game,
yes,
by cooperation.
And yes,
which
agreed.
Begs the interesting question, would we want to artificially intelligent robotic players to, on their great list of things to try, have changed the rules of the game be one of them? Because it seems like there might be complications in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, my theory is always, not always, but it's been there's a thing called Ricardo's rule about dealing with how countries trade with each other. And the idea that if you teach AI that, then they learn to benefit from cooperation. But humans have trouble learning this rule, you know, and even people designing these systems don't accept these rules. And when it comes to politics and stuff, is there are people who are very much into, you know, free flow of information and stuff like that in evolution. And then when you try to apply it to a market system, like, oh, no, that's different. And it's, you know, we run into this all the time of like, no, now we need a top down. We need a command. We need a controlled economy because that's the only way. And it's like, okay, this works in nature, works in, you know, information system, works everywhere else. And, you know, we agree, like, we know, like, no, we know we see this in computer systems, like, this is optimum. This is the same, but it's getting to there. So there is, and you ask about the idea of having it change the rules. So there's another project, I think it's also a DeepMind project, that said, don't worry, we've built an off switch into our AI where we can press this red button and it'll shut it down.
Okay. That works up until the point it gets as smart as you. At which point it figures out that it can put a tarp over the red button and hide it someplace.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's the problem we have, is just we can conceive of somebody a little bit smarter than us, a little bit more aware of us. But when you're trying to conceive and think of something that is, you know, double, twice, triple, because we've never met a person like that. We've met people who maybe might be twice as smart of us at the most extreme, you know, at making those connections faster, seeing those sorts of things. We've never met somebody 5 or 10 times like that or dealt with a lot of them. That is it's an alien thing to us, and it's coming faster. When we first started talking on this podcast, you know, we talked about, hey, yeah, we've lost chess. Maybe we could still win at Go. Go is this much more complicated game. Go might still be the one holdout where humans can still, you know, the complications could be really, really complicated. No. Now they're using DeepMind, was secretly going playing the top Go masters and kicking butt, doing really, really well at it. So,
did you guys see this leaked video from Boston Dynamics, the new wheeled centaur-looking monstrosity?
I heard about it. I didn't see it.
This was from, I guess, a week and change ago. There's a Verge article that has an animated GIF, but somebody did one of those holding up an eye, like, as if it was a bootleg trailer from San Diego Comic-Con. They got some inside footage of it. Here, do you need a link, Bryce?
If you want me to show,
okay, here, I'll pop that over here and over here. You guys describe it. I think it'd be interesting to hear how you guys would contextualize this.
Well, it looks like Brian Brushwood.
That's right. It looks horrific. It's a monstrosity.
Looks like a hooked man.
Everybody thinks we only do legged robots, so no one has seen this. You guys are the first. This is the debut.
Oh, cool.
Oh, Jesus.
So it's like imagine a horse on a mechanical horse on a Segway.
Yeah. It's a horse and chariot in one. It's
Christ, this thing would murder everyone.
Just put some chainsaws on there for arms.
Oh geez. So yeah, it just rolls with the kind of greatest of ease, but it's yet like has these big, almost praying mantis like claws on the front of it that you can just imagine destroying all of humanity.
It's a malevolent Peggy Hamilton.
It's like a horse shape, right? But the back legs have wheels, and it's balancing up on those wheels with the arms out. And
it does. It looks like a horse on roller skates, doing basically ice skating, figure skating. It's pretty exceptional. Oh, I swear to God, if this thing could swim, we're all dead.
That's a road.
Oh, thank goodness! I thought that was a pond.
I swear to God, if you can turn that road into water, we are all screwed.
Oh, it just jumped over a Jersey wall.
Just did an ollie.
Wow. Yeah.
So we're watching these things, these very, very spooky kinds of things move around and make, in some cases, more graceful than people. It's that we're at the start of the acceleration curve. We're maybe a decade away from the really smooth moving robot that walks around like a person, has the grace of a person, dances, jumps, and does all these other things that's creepy, that you think you mistake for a person, that you're walking down the street and you're like, I think we just passed a robot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, robots in our cars, robots in our,
but
in our lives.
I mean, like the actual, like, mistaking, you know.
Oh, sure. I mean, I already get phone calls where there is a brief superposition where I don't know if it's a human or a robot. And then
Grant. You realized it was a robot. Oh,
well, and sometimes it'll be, you know, one of those hybrids where it's like they can pay a lower wage person who doesn't have to speak English perfectly just to basically click on a soundboard with canned responses through their whole sales thing. And so, you know, the best one I heard, I don't know if I told you this, but Bryce, I think, got called by the same one.
I got one in a pre-show to a Night Attack.
And yeah.
They do it from the area code that you're from. So it had my home area code, and I thought, oh, maybe it's somebody I know who got a new phone number. And you pick it up, and you hear, oh, wait, can you hear me? Sorry, give me a sec.
You actually hear fumbling with a microphone, and then so that you're like, hello? And then you hear someone, you know, basically off camera, off mic, say like, oh, shoot, hold on. And you hear fumbling, and then you hear a woman laughing, and she said, I didn't have my headset on. Hi, are you there? And then you're like, yes. And they're like, oh, good. This is Sandra. I'm calling about your free vacation getaway or whatever. And then at that point, you've invested, like, they're getting smarter. The writers of the AI programs are getting smarter.
I'd argue it's more social engineering.
Sure.
Like, that's just a tape that plays when it picks up.
I mean, I think that's all it's ever going to be is figuring out the human condition and what people are likely to say, and then, you know, figuring out pre-programmed.
I mean, maybe
response.
Though, but maybe also it's like if it is getting smarter and it becomes easier and easier to stitch together, like, vocal stuff, then why not be like, man, beautiful day. Like, you know, like, hey, there's it's raining where you are, right? Like, there's just some way to know, you know, to like, hey, that Trump, huh? Like, hey, you know, just some way to kind of hook you in, because that's basically what they're doing, is the most clever version of, oh, this is a legitimate person talking to me.
Well, and at some point, you know, they'll be so good that they'll provide significant value and become a valued part of your relationships and so on, which made me think of, was it yesterday or the day before, Bryce, we were talking about commenting systems, and I had an idea that I think is clever and that somebody should make, and I want to know what you guys think.
Loading up my Ruby compiler right now. Go for it.
Great. Okay. So, problem with comments is people get nasty and they don't speak very well, and they mean one thing, but then they say something awful, and then everyone reads it, and everyone wants to get paper cuts on their eyeballs because comments are terrible. And so then a bunch of journalism places say, no more comments. Comments are bad. Nobody's allowed to talk about it. What if there was a reCAPTCHA for commenting, so that on your channel on YouTube, you could type whatever you wanted, and then just say, great, we're about to post it. Take a look at this comment and just check yes or no. Does this meet the minimum standards of civility that you expect for this channel? And then if the answer is no, then somebody else's comment doesn't get posted. Yours still goes through the queue because you've now performed the service of briefly analyzing somebody else's stuff. And then so if somebody, it just says a bunch of no, somebody writes, you know, fag or whatever, and then it just gets washed out by the system, they get a polite note saying, hey, we tested your comment. It didn't meet minimum standards of civility for this channel. Would you like to try again? Here's a suggested way to state that better.
Let me play devil's advocate here. What happens when you're the minority opinion? And also, too, do people really understand what civility is? Because I hear a lot of people talk about, you know, go high when they go low, who do not do a good job of going high. Well, you know, I hear a lot of people who talk about being anti-hate who are very, very filled with hate. I watch a lot of people who are very violent when it comes to defending their own opinions and accusing other people of being violent. Both sides. And so I don't know that people know what that is. I think because it's like, oh, violence never. Well, that person's evil, so it's okay.
So there's an easy fix for that. If that's important to you, because there are some places on the internet where it's important that the bubble be preserved and they don't want to hear from the left side or the right. So instead, you could be one of those where it's like, yeah, oh, you said a blue state thing, that's kicked out. You said a red state thing, nobody upvoted it or whatever. But let's say you select the option saying, I would like all sides represented. Then all it is somebody who posts something gets a different reCAPTCHA that says this person, this comment was voted down for being anti-civil. Is it anti-civil or do you suspect it was voted down for partisanship? And then you just, you know, you read it and you're like, well, clearly, I mean, that was very civilly put and this guy disagreed with it and voted it down. And so you mark it then. And then at that point, you can decide the rules for your community. That basically it's like, hi, welcome. You're in comment reCAPTCHA. What are the things that are important to you? Here are the check boxes. Do you care about, not demonizing the other side? Do you care about just proper language? Do you care about all caps? What are the things you care about? And then basically that becomes not with brute force, but instead it becomes a simple nudge where if people want to be heard, they learn to speak in the voice that you expect from this community.
So, again, playing devil's advocate on that, and there was just a study that came out about hostile comments on Wikipedia, how much of them are coming from anonymous people, but also that there's something like they're like 30% of, you know, I forget like what they considered, like there is some of the most highly active non-anonymous people were super active and downvoting or criticizing other people because there are motivated blocks there to have one vote said that we're going to spend far more time policing what opposing points of view. And that was sort of the problem is that, like, I think that, you know, my problem with a lot of these online, I understand kind of like why I think some reasons like they, you know, one of the reasons I think that some of these sites stopped doing that was because these people were bashing the reporters. Because some of these sites, I noticed that they were like super critical of some of the coverage if they got things wrong or whatever. And I think reporters have extremely thin skin, but also like Wikipedia's
an
example.
Hey, what are you talking about me for? Shut up.
I take it all back. And I think that the problem is you get in like Wikipedia is an example where there's a small group of editors there who are known entities who are extremely police certain things and you can't get certain things or certain points of view up there because that's their territory that they've staked that out. And there are people who will never get Wikipedia pages because there are people who have grudges against them and stuff. And so I'm not saying your solution wouldn't work at all, Brian. I'm just saying, I'm just looking at like it'd be better than what we have. It certainly would be better. I'm just looking at how things are sort of gamed by the most toxic sort of users already.
Yeah, and it's a problem, you know, but I do like your idea, Brian, in that there's what you want to do is ultimately reward the people that are spending the most time there in the best way that connects with your content, right? Like that's ultimately what you want to reward. And in a perfect world, it would also make the coverage better, you know, because you would be able to separate the legitimate criticism of, let's say, what Andrew was talking about, where people get it wrong or it's lazy or it's unnamed or something and it winds up going back to bite them in the ass from just the out-and-out vile trash that also tends to surface. But I think the larger question is that kind of commentary, the best kind of commentary, if we're going to imagine it, does that have to come from more involvement? Are you ultimately just top weighting your community by saying, okay, well, if you want to answer six questions about things, then you will be, your opinion will be felt more than, somebody else.
I think that's a very important point. Like, can we start off with like, what are the rules of civility? Cause I think that's,
Well, you know, and that's the beauty of it is the system, as I would imagine it, is defined by the community. So it's like there is a particular demographic, a particular type of people, and all, like, basically you say, hey, I like these kinds of comments in my space, my little corner of the internet, and what I represent and what I want to do. I don't care for these. You know, for example, like Scam School. Like, if you're gonna say dumb hair or whatever, like, hey, that's out. That's not helpful. You're not adding to the conversation. We're all aware that Brian had a very wacky hairstyle 10 years ago. So, and
but he's over it, guys. He's over it.
Yeah. So I write a rule saying, is it a comment about someone's hair or appearance? Because none of that is relevant to what we're doing on Scam School. Like, that chick's fat. Yeah, that dude's ugly. Let's just say full stop. I want that. Like. You know, hey, here's the guidelines, and then the enforcement is just basically the asymmetry. It takes you 30 to 60 seconds to write a comment. It takes you 5 seconds to look at someone else's comment and know whether or not it meets the guidelines.
Let me ask you a question, though, okay? So if somebody made a comment and mentioned, like, Donald Trump being orange.
Well, I mean, I don't have an opinion one way or another on that. But like for example, there's some stuff that is found distasteful in certain areas that I don't mind at all. I actually think it's adorable that everybody races to write the word first, because eventually those all fall away and end up at the bottom. And it's fun. It's like when they say first, what they're really saying is, I am a tremendous fan of this channel and I feel special in this brief moment where I appear to be the first one to have unwrapped the new box. And so as a result, you know, you would not find a guideline that says nobody say first on this channel or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so whenever if it says first and it says, you know, and somebody's typing in like, well, the problem with the double lift is blah, blah, blah. And then they finish it and it says, hey, does this, you know, is there anything offensive by the community standards for this channel on this comment? And they look and it says first. And it's like, no, that's not offensive. And then they answer it. And so it goes. Now, nobody reads it, but meanwhile, it's gone through the system and it's, you know, deemed inoffensive. Now, you could, you know, whether or not, and I think I see what you're nibbling at, which is if somebody has an unpopular political opinion, they could be unfairly marginalized in that their comments don't come out. But my guess is they'll learn to not involve politics in their commenting on the Scam School channel. And I'd be okay with that.
Well, I don't, I guess what I'm saying though is that, like, if, you know, I go to an LA party and I know everybody's opinion or everybody's professed, everybody's going to be in the same mindset, same mindset about things like this. And people will prefer political opinions and things like that without even wondering what your politics are. Cause if you're at a party in Hollywood, then obviously you're the same sort of mindset. And you see this sort of this in-group mentality, though, like the whole thing, like not commenting on personal appearance. Like, so if I make, you know, if I say that, you know, Trump has, you know, Cheeto colored skin, or make this sort of comment, that circle, everybody like, yeah. And then we could slide right into like, yeah, we should never make fun of people's personal appearances. That would never register. They would never register that first thing was a negative comment about somebody's personal appearance.
Right.
You know, we get lectures about body shaming from people who then will go body shame somebody they disagree with.
All of that, there's a place to do that. I think that there's much lower hanging fruit to be fixed in an easy method by doing this kind of thing. But again, it was just a shallow thought.
I do think that there is an interesting idea, though, is that no matter what, even if, let's say, you have programmatically tried to solve what you are talking about, will the enforcement of the laws always trend toward the kind of majority rules solution for it? Is any moderation tool, no matter how well-intentioned, always going to be a sword for the people that spend the most time commenting and their personal views on it, whether or not they agree with the personal views of the channel?
Yes, but essentially another way to say what you're saying is, yeah, but isn't this a problem because the people who define the community will be the ones who judge what the community is best at? You know what I mean? Like, Let's say there's two places. One, the Scam School channel. One, the Magic Should Always Be Kept Secret from Everyone channel, right? They're going to have different communities that will have different values, right? And so, yeah, the people who are most engaged in the nobody should ever mention that magic is anything other than wizard powers people are going to be the ones who are in the recaptchas saying like, yeah, this guy is intimating that maybe he doesn't actually have mind powers. So, nah, I don't like it. I don't like it. And so it doesn't meet the threshold. But that's exactly what that community wants, right? That's adhering to the standards of that community. So in that regard, it's just a way to distribute over the maximum statistically significant number of people to get the most accurate types of comments for each community is the idea.
Yeah. Oh, no. I think it's a very interesting one. I guess the meta to the meta to the meta would be like, well, the people that have the largest amount of comments in communities like Reddit, which has obviously done arguably the best and worst job simultaneously of commenting and moderating and giving people tools, still have fairly bare tools to do it. Because I think that there is, you know, for every clever solution, there is the question that we need to ask, do more tools make us better? Or ultimately, are the simple tools with people who care about them just going to get us the best result anyway?
Well, right now what we're seeing, and this is what this is a response to, is like, it's a real bummer to me that so many publications are just removing comments, because I feel like comments have value. And what they don't want to do is you know, create. It's like somebody posts an article, and the only way to gauge the reaction to the article is they set up a boxing ring with spotlights on it and an announcer who, as each competitor comes in, is announced, entering the boxing ring, equipped with the Mace of Death. It's the Uber user 912. It's like, yeah, they're going to fight because you built a boxing ring, you know? Whereas, you know, that doesn't happen when you walk into an MIT lecture hall. And I'm just saying, I think there are ways to shape the reactions so that you guide the kind of discourse that you want.
Yeah, I totally see your point. I think, it would be curious to see.
I agree.
Also, it'll never happen because wished it. And
part
said it
part of the reasons why those companies got rid of comments instead of getting something like Discuss or other commenting systems is also because the fraction of people who comment on an article is very small, even in good instances. Like there's a value proposition to trying to fix a small but very nasty problem in some of these.
That's true, but I guess I think they're throwing the baby out with the bathwater, because compared to the total listenership of Weird Things, mm-hmm. the number of people currently participating in the chat room is I would say equally small as a percentage, but I would say outsized important in that they provide a live studio audience and we get a statistically significant imprint of what we're saying and how it's landing with people on the fly.
There's been, I would say, in some circles in media and online media, there's been a mistake, and part of it's driven by like when your primary focus and your quarterly focus is on eyeballs and ad dollars, is not understanding the difference between a deep audience and a broad audience. And so, you know, like Diamond Club and the projects we do here, it may not be huge, but the audience is extremely deep. And I've noticed this when I'm out with Brian and Justin, and I see the interactions, you know, that you know, people get more excited to see them than I've seen people get excited to be celebrities, you know. And that has the benefits are is that when you want to influence within your group, that's extremely powerful. And I think that some of these media companies that don't want to deal with comments for whatever sort of reasons, because they just want to focus on getting, you know, spread in a wide thing, they're commoditizing themselves. They're becoming just another thing, just another bunch of text, and they're becoming, you know, they're following sort of problems the same the traditional newspapers did, in my opinion.
Yeah. You know. Yeah. Anyway, just an idea. Someone out there steal it, make it.
Gentlemen, do you know what time it is?
Oh, you better tell me what time it is.
It's time for picks. Oh, wait. No, we could do it. My pick is Journey Quest.
We had a bit of a roller coaster the last Journey Quest, right?
Yeah. We apparently successfully went back in time. We were surrounded by warring knights. We were eventually whisked off as jesters be the entertainment for, was it a duke or a king? I think it was a king.
I think it was a duke.
Duke. And then... All right. So we were going to entertain the duke. Brian and I got through a full performance of the funk shop before we realized that we had yet to walk in to appease the Duke. We then got angry with each other and started arguing, at which point we did not know whether or not he was laughing hysterically or dying. And I think that's where we left off.
So as an aside, I'll explain to you that I had a friend that was, for some reason, with the America's Got Talent auditions, they saw another friend, spoke to him, and then he told me, he said, yeah, I don't think he notices that he was in the loser line. You know, what do you mean? Like, well, they have this separate line to make people wait, the people you know they're going to go on and they're going to suck. And I don't think he realized that's where he was. I'm like, ouch. I'm not saying that's the line you guys were in front of the Duke.
Got it.
But the people waiting in line were entertained, though. Okay.
Good.
So you went into the chamber, and yes, you started your show and you heard some, may have been laughter, may have been mirthing, and then you hear this.
Yeah. That's a long time. So are we in the chamber right now?
You're in the chamber. Fact, you two and this darkened room, candle lit, and you see this bed with these curtains drawn over it where you hear the sounds coming from.
Okay, real quick. I'm just like, I gotta take a little peek. See, I lean forward and just with my middle finger just kind of pry back, just take a look.
Oh, Brian, not your middle finger. It's, come on, keep it. We don't need to spill blood all over the place. It's your pointer finger that you need to keep pointing.
Okay, got it. Oh, yeah, that's right. I keep my finger extended and I use my pointing finger to pull back the curtain.
And you see the body of a man in bed, a heavyset man, large beard, gray hair, mouth agape.
I kind of shake him.
Screen cap that one, folks.
Shake him a little bit. I go.
His jolly belly shakes back and forth.
Yeah. Okay. This guy is D.E.D. dead. And so will we be if we do not get the F word all about this piece immediately. Okay. Let's. I investigate.
Hold on. Hold on. Justin,
chambers for an exit.
I don't. Just, there's no wrong answers in brainstorming. The problem is we're dead. If they figure out he's dead, like, what if they think he's still alive and is a very big fan of us?
Oh my God, we are not Weekend at Bernie's-ing this.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, it just seems like, and I grab his arm and I drape it over my shoulder and I clumsily try to pull him off the bed while I
He's
grab...
He's a very heavy man. Very heavy man.
I'm not succeeding, but I grab the bottom of his beard and I kind of tug it, hoping that it will open and close his mouth as I do a little ventriloquism. They're like, come on, just see, we'll go forward.
You hear a knock. A lot of bootsteps too outside the door. How's it going in there?
Great. Be careful of the things that you use, because you could get arrested. Sorry, we're in the middle of our song.
All right. Now you notice there's a string attached to going through the wall, and it's like tied around his little finger. And like, well, he hasn't rung the bell yet, so you're doing pretty good.
Oh, well, we're getting along famously. You should see the grin on his face at the funk shop.
Oh, what's that? A reprise? There's only one place that you can go.
Guys, he's loving it, so I guess it'll be a bit.
All right. Well, we're going to send in his banquet dinner.
He definitely.
Oh, he's shaking his head. No, he's saying no. he's actually trying to drop a few lbs. So just go ahead and keep the banquet dinner.
He said, leave it at the door.
Okay, serving winches are leaving it at the door.
Okay.
If the bell rings, we're rushing in. Just so you know.
Yep.
This is some kind of trick.
Yep. You got it.
No, it's not a trick. No trick.
I walk over to the door and I crack it open just enough to. Yeah, I mean, what's this King Duke get for dinner?
All right, so you see like a big silver platter with like a big, like, you know, Cornish hen on, I mean, hens, hams, there's roast potatoes, there's a bunch of stuff, there's a big bowl of soup there, like fancy soup, there's several plates, some silverware and stuff like that.
With all those meats, I assume there's some knives?
Yes, great. There are knives and forks.
I wheel everything
and all that
in, I close the door, I lock the door, and I hand Justin a knife.
All right, now we're talking. What do? Carve them up?
We're not going to eat the king.
What?
Did you take the food?
Well, yeah, no. I mean, I'm holding the ham hock in my left hand, okay, and I'm just eating it like a cartoon Bugs Bunny in
hey,
medieval
around,
times.
Look, like, this is a really nice room. You know, it's pretty ornate. You know, it's got some nice furnishings, some couches and some stuff.
Justin, I have a theory. Nobody this important has a bedroom with only this one door to escape. I guarantee you he's got to have, you've seen Game of Thrones, there's got to be some kind of sneaky back door to get other Duke's wives in and out. Okay, let's hunt around and see if we can find a secret door to get out of here.
Let's also look for a regular door, just a back door.
Also, have you tried these garlic mashed potatoes? They're really fantastic. I mean,
I inspect the room for doors. What do I find?
You find a tapestry hanging there. There's a cold current coming from there, and you pull it open, and you see actually a tunnel.
Told you.
I mean, we got to go. We got to get the hell out of here.
Okay.
All right, carb loading. Brian and I carb load, eat shoveling mashed potatoes in our mouths. And
right before we go, I take the mashed potatoes and I sculpt giant cartoonish eyebrows on the corpse of the king, and then and I weave it into his beard, and I spell out with P's, best show ever, grant them a pardon, on his chest.
I died smiling.
I died of joy.
And also, we try to push his cheeks up so it looks like he's smiling.
I take two celery stalks and I prop them up comically on the bed so he's in a perpetual smile.
All right. No, wait. Hold on. Wait a minute. We came here because there were two sides fighting, right?
Yeah.
Did we remember what the other side was?
No. But meanwhile, I've also pulled his pants down around his ankles.
All right. Andrew, do we remember what the other side was?
No, you don't. You don't. You just know there was another fight, another kingdom.
All I know is this.
I smear in gravy. Viva other side.
Wait, why? Oh, no.
So you go into the corridor and you see about 12 minute arms standing there waiting there. Oh, does the king need our help? Does the duke need our help? Is the duke okay?
I said, actually, the duke is sleeping. He's having a very fine rest after such a hearty belly laugh. Obviously, the bell didn't ring. So
you know we're telling the truth.
He is getting a few Z's, and he said if anybody comes in here until I call for them, I am going to take their nuts off their junk, and I'm going to put them somewhere else. And I don't really get what he meant, but he was sure serious about getting a little shut-eye. So he just told us to hit the bricks and see you later.
He asked us also to be escorted all the way to the gates of the city. Where we're
right, like, well, we have to take you to the front to do that. We can't bring you out this back door.
He said you would say that, and he said that if you did, then he's supposed to remind you of why you guys are guarding this back room, and just think
when
about that.
When I was put into position here, he said my job was to help him escape if he needed to escape, but to keep anybody else trying to escape from there from escaping in the event that they maybe secretly murdered him or something like that, or to rush in if he needed help, like if I haven't heard the bell ring in a couple hours, in 2 hours.
Huh.
But and it's about an hour and 50 minutes since the last time I heard the bell ring. I'm a little suspicious.
Ooh. He also said to us that that's what you would say, and that's why he told us to give you the special wink, because your mom's name was Martha.
I cross my fingers and then I quietly whisper under my breath, Adolf, what are the odds that medieval people's names were Martha.
Well, that was my stepmother, so wrong.
Oh, but a hit nonetheless.
Any hear from the other end of the chamber? How's it going in there? We've got the dessert tray.
There's only one.
Can we send the serving witch into the dessert tray now?
Okay. I look up. I pissed my pants, and I'm like, oh golly, I really have to go to the bathroom.
They're like, hey, the guy at the door's like, I need to come in and check because we heard about this other dukedom where two entertainers went in there, murdered the duke, tried to escape, you know.
Okay, I guess realizing...
If they'd been smart enough to pretend that he was still alive, they could have run the whole show, but thankfully they weren't. They just tried to get away, but thankfully... They were killed and decapitated.
Their parts
were put in their mouth parts.
I say, oh well, the dessert's here, Justin. I guess let's go. Sorry, Centurions.
I'll tell you what. Yeah, hey, back guards.
Kudos.
Great
to
job.
You.
Great job. Say hi to Martha for me. We're gonna just get back in there because these assholes in the front apparently are not respecting the Duke's nap, and we got to give them a good talking to.
All right, so we flop down the tapestry, gaze at each other significantly, and we comically put our fingers in our collars as we grimace. Is a close one.
Right. I confidently stride to the door. I open it and I say, "Hey." Penis breath. You trying to get us all killed? Huh? You think this is a game? Think this is a game? We made that man laugh so hard, that he fell asleep. He's like a peaceful little baby right now. He told us.
All right, I'm coming in there. I'm coming in there in about exactly the same amount of time it would take for you to put the body under the bed, put Brian under the sheets, and pretend he's the Duke.
Okay.
I'm coming in right now because I got a declaration of war from the rival kingdom.
I mouthed the words, told you to Justin, as I very quickly grab the body, stuff it underneath, get underneath, throw the sheets over my head, and I place the giant ham over my belly so I have a similarly rotund figure as the king.
I continue to fight with the guy and make him earn every inch of opening that door, saying that the king is asleep, and eventually give way.
All right. He stands in the room, looks at you, and is like, did we send one or two of you in here?
It's just me. I have a one-man show. It's called The Funk Shop, and it's great. And I made that man laugh so hard that he fell asleep. Hey, you want to know what? Hey, hold on. Wait a minute. What's your name? Huh?
Listen, my name is Captain Roderick. I'm not really a captain. My parents had military ambitions for me. That's irrelevant, all right? I'm asking the question.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Let me go over to my new best friend, the king. Or the duke, rather. King Duke. Hey, because he's a king in my heart. I don't know about you. Hey, Duke. Duke, I know you told nobody to wake you up, but Captain Roderick here apparently just needs to have some questions answered because he's so important.
I jut out a finger that's pointing because that's all I can do, and I point up in the air and I shake it as if I'm upset, but then I level it to roughly where I think the captain is, and I kind of shake it, and then I go, like,
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
And then
we've
I do a sweeping
motion.
We've
got the enemy forces at our borders, and we need a decision made soon.
And then I
we raise the army. We raise the army.
Okay. I still am pointing, but now I'm also giving a thumbs up. And then I do the like a little click clack thing on my hand.
All right, I go back to the door. Hey, we're raising the army. Get the army. Everybody raise the army. All right, bring in the blind the blind servants with the armor for the Duke. Okay. We've got to suit them up for battle.
All right, so I with my full
why
hand.
Be blind? I don't know why he made a request.
Hey, usher them towards me. And then, but as they get close, I say stop, and then I paw, open up the curtains just enough to take the pieces of the armor.
Okay, meanwhile, I go out to stand with Captain Roderick, and I'm like, hey, number one, totally wrong foot. What do you say we just go ahead and hit that old reset button and get this one back to triple zeros between me and you? So, not to tell tales out of school, but the King Duke, again, king in my heart, Duke on paper, he loved the funk shop so much that he's made me his new strategic military advisor. So why don't you go ahead and just give me the old cocktail napkin version of what the hey is going on here?
Well, our enemy, as you know, is at our border. They're about to invade.
Obviously.
And we need to repel the invasion. And what we're going to try to do is we're going to do like a pincer move, go through and around, and we're going to attack their castle.
Sure. Okay. And who, just again, so I get the pronunciation right, I don't want to embarrass anybody in court. Who runs the other kingdom there?
Next time on Journey Quest.
Real quick, I jump out fully in the armor, and from behind the armor, I say, "Do the funk shop again."
I kneel right away.
Hey, man, I got a pick for you guys.
Right.
It came out a little while ago. Revisited it. It's kind of been the butt of jokes for a while. But I saw it through the eyes of my children, who had never even heard of it before, and I was astonished at how well James Cameron's Avatar stands up. Like, when you watch it with kids who don't know that it's just the plot of Fern Gully, when you watch it with kids who don't know that it's bad writing to say, this planet will eat your eyes like jujubes, when they don't know that... it was riding the wave of 3D gimmickry at the time. It's extremely simple storytelling, exquisitely told. The animation holds up all these years later. It's been almost a decade now, right?
2009.
Yeah. So many of the interactions, you know, there's language differences or whatever. And so to take the challenge of telling a story just in significant glances at times, and on top of that, to make them computer animated significant glances between, you know, motion captured actors. It was great. It was great. I enjoyed it an awful lot. It's got a fantastic first act. First act is so brilliant because it's like sci-fi world. Guy doesn't have legs. Oh, and his brother's dead. I wonder if he can make a new life without legs. What? He got legs? He's a blue alien? What an amazing world. Like, it does a great job of foreshadowing and setting everything up. And you're spending the whole second act exploring the world and falling in love with it. You don't even realize you fall in love with it until all of a sudden they blow up a tree. And then you're like, oh, I cared about that tree. Anyway, it's good. You should watch it again.
My argument for Avatar has always been that with the brilliance of James Cameron is that he engineers his movies, you know, very, very meticulously. And he designed a movie that could play the same in Bangkok as it could in Manhattan. And there's some movies that are really popular here and not popular in other countries. That was a movie that was designed to sort of reach everybody. And I don't like the term like lowest common denominator because that's kind of racist. I mean, in the sense that to make a story that could translate well into multiple languages and become a global phenomenon. And that's not easy. And he did that with Avatar.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, it's four quadrant global. Like, that's, you know, and if you think that that's an easy thing to do, then, you know, I think the sales will show you otherwise.
Yeah. I mean, there are people, and it's funny because you get this, there'll be sort of a dismissive sort of thing. And we're seeing in our chat right now, like, it's this. It's like, it's hard to write. It's like children's books. It's harder to write a good children's book than a good adult book. You might read it as an adult. You're like, this is like simple. It's like there's a lot that goes into it. And Cameron's like that. You know, you look at like in some of his stuff, True Lies, stuff like that. Just great. Goes into genres that have been done before. Does it. Hits it. It may not be like, it doesn't. It for us, it's not like we go, oh, it's great. But enough people go, this is really good. It becomes the biggest box office success of all time. And when back when that performer before Avatar Tower came out, like, well, will it do Titanic numbers? Man, that's not really reasonable. Well, it did. And also it took advantage of ticket price inflation, 3D inflation, all these other things, to be sure. But how well it played around the world was absolutely fascinating. And it's like Michael Bay. Michael Bay is got extreme skills. And you see the difference between a Michael Bay film and somebody trying to do Michael Bay-like stuff. And you're aware of like, oh, he really gets motion and kinetic stuff. He tries to make each character pop. He doesn't try to waste a single moment or stuff. And sometimes it's just drives you up the wall because like, all right, this is really just not good in some ways. But every little bits and moments of it are, there's so much craft that goes into it, in my opinion.
I agree. In fact, yeah. Actually, I went over so well with the kids that I think I'm going to try to get them to watch The Abyss next. I think they'll have a good one with that one.
Yeah, nice. That's a... That you look at what ended up making The Abyss. Oh my God. Mm. You know, the underwater stuff, all of that. Incredible. Justin.
Documentary. There was a time that NBC decided to take a stand and not play into the escalating rights fees for the NFL. They said, the idea, the paradigm had shifted. The NFL was going to charge, knowing that they would be a loss leader for networks. And they escalated their rights to this astronomical thing. So Dick Ebersol, head of NBC Sports, said, nope, we don't want to do that anymore, and decided to gamble a fraction of that money in an idea he hatched with his friend Vince McMahon called the XFL. And for 30... is called This Was the XFL and is awesome. Like, just an amazing little slice of the great and terrible XFL. It's directed by Charlie Ebersol, Dick's son, and is very much about the relationship between those two people. The fact that they are both alive and they can both tell stories now is great. But really, the documentary has this amazing, fun little epilogue where two guys that, you know, listen, among the resume for Dick Ebersol is helping to invent Saturday Night Live. You know, this is a guy who really gets television. Vince McMahon is obviously the pro wrestling empresario. There's a scene at the end where they are just having dinner and they're talking about the XFL and kind of some of the personal fallout that they had and who was at fault, and it's them admitting mistakes that they made, and then it just kind of seamlessly kind of segues into them both getting into the like scheming and dreaming of like, yeah, but what if we did it again and what would we do different? And they start to get into like little tidbits of like, oh well, you know, Jerry Jones is a friend of ours, and he has this gigantic stadium in Dallas. And maybe what if we ran it a little smaller scale and we ran it all out of one stadium and everything? And to see two guys who have created massive brands that have really like reached in. I mean, you how easily we forget, because the XFL turned out to be such an intense failure. But that first game got 54 million people, and the number that they wound up getting even by the end of it, when it was looked at absolute, you know, like an absolute tire fire, is still something that people would pay hundreds of millions of dollars for rights fees now.
Yeah.
Just great. Just amazing.
I love the idea that at the end of it, as an extra bonus, you get to see a hint of what it was, of that exact magic, that twinkle in their eye when it happened, like that live chemistry of whatever the next reimagining might be.
Very cool.
No, very good. Highly recommend it.
My pick is, I just started listening to this, but I'm kind of digging it. I was looking for some just sort of kind of old school adventure sci-fi, and it's Jack Vance's Planet of Adventure, which is available on Audible, where they combine several of these novels. And it's, you know, guy on an alien planet just trying to get by, and it, you know, shows up and there are already people there because they realizes that throughout history, aliens have been bringing humans there as slaves, but like from different periods of time. So the humans are radically different in, you know, how they look. So it's a very, very cool story so far. Just, you know, good, you know, classic sort of sci-fi adventure.
Cool.
So I'm enjoying it so far. that's my pick. Gentlemen, it's been weird.
Goddamn right.
Number one.
All right, Brian. So I have Hotline Monday at 2 my time.
If we keep rolling right now, I think we can get a decent sized review of
Split. Yeah, I apologize for putting a hard out on things, but I can totally if we're normally rolling, you know, this far, then I can talk about moving Hotline Monday.
We had mechanical equipment issues, yeah.
Is this all just going to be a?
Yeah, I think so. I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
What I was saying is a spoiler. People who are watching, this is going to be a spoilery review of Split.
Right.
From everybody.
And we're going to announce when it. We will make that clear to anyone who starts it.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. I also got that. All right. You guys ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Take it away in 3, 2.
Welcome to After Things, the podcast after Weird Things, where we talk about things. I'm joined by Brian Brushwood. I'm
true.
Andrew Main, and
that's
the other guy is Justin Robert Young.
Mahoy.
How's that for an intro, guys?
It's great.
So we're going to talk, I think we'll start off with a discussion of Split, but also the fact that like we're in this really very interesting era where Blumhouse, the production company, which does a lot of this, you know, small budget horror, and it's not really micro budget, but it's, you know, a couple million dollar picks. They have like a very interesting strategy, and what they do is they look for directors who have experience directing, people who may have been big names, people who've done stuff and maybe have some experience in doing directing, writing, whatever. Give them a lot more control over a project. They get a lot smaller money. Like I think, you know, the budget for Split was, let's pull this up on Box. It's got to be like $8 million or something like that. It was not a lot of money. And part of what they'll do is they will take these projects, develop them, and then decide it was a $9 million budget. Then decide how much marketing dollars or whatever they want to put into it. And they've had other projects I've heard that just sort of sit on the shelves and do that. But they work with established directors who they know have had a lot of experience, are capable of, you know, delivering a film, and give them, you know, a little more freedom. And for directors, sometimes it's a very attractive opportunity. You're not doing a bigger budget movie, but when you do a bigger budget movie, you have so many more people who want to weigh in and tell you what you can and cannot do. And sometimes you lose a sense of it doesn't feel like it's your project, yet the decisions they make affect you, and you can find yourself in a big project and executives insisting on stuff that you can't be vocal, and you never hear the side. I almost never hear the side of it when they talk about it, where they're like, they're not going to tell you like, the studio, if you're in a position of power, you'll say this, or if you're outside, you'll say it, but you're still working in the system. You're not going to say, no, studio made me cast this actor. He was horrible, didn't remember his lines. It took us forever to do it. They made us use the script, which I said we had problems with it, but you know, the writer was a friend of the exec who greenlit us or whatever. You don't hear that, and that happens a lot in big projects. So the Blumhouse models, let's take people, let's give them more control, more freedom to go do this because the risk is much lower because the payoff is great. So right now, Split is what we're going to talk about. Was made for $9 million. Its domestic gross right now is $112 million, which, you know, obviously studio doesn't get all of it, gets roughly half of that, but also it's a good indication of what it'll do in home video and all that. It's going to have probably a 10-to-1 earnings ratio, you know,
huge,
probably by the end of it, which is great. Really, really great success. And it's directed by M. Night Shyamalan, who started off, you know, with, you know, in the 90s with, you know, a great, you know, this is a guy who did Sixth Sense, which was huge, huge successful film. He did other films like I really enjoyed, like I like Signs even more in that moment. I loved Unbreakable was one of my favorite films that he did. And then he kind of got into this sort of what's the twist going to be kind of thing. And that made it where sometimes a twist is meant to reframe the entire movie property or the entire movie, which I think was sort of a problem with things like The Village and stuff, because if you knew what the twist was going in or whatever, it's just kind of a dull movie about people in a village. Now he has Split when he's doing it with Blumhouse. I think it's his second project he did with him. I think he did.
I believe he did the creepy grandparents movie,
The Visit,
right?
Yeah.
Which was supposed to be pretty good, right?
Yeah, I've heard good things about that. So and that did The Visit at a domestic $65 million gross. And looking up the stats on this stuff. So Yeah, he wrote and directed, and that was a Blumhouse project too. So now he's doing, he seems to be doing, thriving really, really well there. Worldwide, $100 million gross. And then, you know, that was a movie with a $5 million budget. So, you know, he seems to have found, you know, found his groove in doing these kinds of projects. So we're going to do a very spoilery discussion of Split.
Yeah. However, so you know. But before we move into spoiler territory, this will probably be the last opportunity for you to pull the ripcord and leave. Know this, I saw Split today because Jeff Cannata tweeted, you know, do yourself a favor, don't read anything about the Split, don't know anything about Split, just go. Just go and you'll be delighted for very good reasons. And and so I did, but you had the inverse experience. So now is the chance to rip the cord. From here on out, it's only going to get more spoilery.
Well, we won't spoil it. I would just say, let me just make this clear. The reason, Justin, you saw it because I told you to see it, right?
Well, okay. Because you told me the spoiler.
Yeah, I found out whether I was not going to see it. I was nobody I knew was like, oh, you got to go see this thing, whatever. So I'm like, and I read this thing like, oh, here, and like read a caption says this, knowing the spoiler makes it better. I'm like, huh, all right, I'll read this because I had nothing invested. I wasn't planning to see it. I read it. And then I'm like, oh, now I want to see this. Because, yeah. You know, my fear of what a traditional M. Night Shyamalan spoiler would be, it wasn't that case, you know, of like, you know, of something like The Village, you know. And so once I read that spoiler, I'm like, oh, well, now you've piqued my interest now. So, and then I saw it, and that's the only reason I saw it was that. And then I came out and told Justin, you need to go see this because it's, and I'll tell you what the spoiler is because he has the same position as me. And then that was motivated you.
Yeah, I would not have gone to see it if I didn't. If Andrew hadn't told me it. Although, let me just say
this. We're going to tell you, if you're comfortable hearing what the spoiler is, we will tell you the spoiler of it. And it's not a spoiler kind of thing. And I'll be clear like that. A spoiler is, it's a cool thing that happens. If you're like, hey, guys, convince me I'm going to go see it. But if you're like, all right, tell me what this thing is. Because it will either be really cool or you'll be like, yeah, and?
So if I had done what Jeff Cannata implored the world to do, and what you indeed did, Brian, this would have been my experience. Went to the theater, got my ticket. I scanned it on the phone for the guy. The guy goes, oh, I think you're the first person to go see it. I'm like, cool. It's like, do you like M. Night Shyamalan movies? And I'm like, yeah, kind of. More the older ones than the newer ones. And he's like, oh, do you like Unbreakable? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, well, you better make sure you stay till the end.
Oh, God. Did that actually happen?
Literally happened. And I almost like, I'm like, I want to get you fired. You're a piece of garbage. It's like, I hate you.
It's like,
I'm like, I'm glad that I knew this going in. But like you almost like it's like somebody blew peanut dust in my face and was like, I hope you don't have an allergy.
Yeah, right. It's like, good thing I happen to go to the movies in my spoiler proof armor since you're jabbing spoilers in my chest.
Wow. So, but I understand. I don't agree with what I took my friend Adam Franklin to go see it. And Adam is a big film guy. And I said, Adam, you want to go see it? I said, well, have you seen it? Like, I said, you know, there's a spoiler I can tell you that may make you want to, like, nope, don't tell me I'm going to see it. I'm like, cool. You're going to see it. That's good. I would only use this to get you to see it. And so the spoiler is, it doesn't affect what happens in the movie itself. It's just at the end of the movie. We can just talk whatever. At the end of the movie, like the movie, the particular protagonist manages to get away. The bad guy gets away, and then we cut to a diner, and there's the news report is playing, and talking about this, you know, the serial killer, the multiple personality character, and the camera pulls across there, and somebody says, "Oh, that reminds me of that. What was that other killer? That serial killer guy?" And then the camera moves over, and there is David Dunn, a.k.a. Bruce Willis, with his Dunn written on his jacket.
On his chest, you know? Just in case you were wondering, is it really the same
music
character?
And the music started before, like the Unbreakable music started before. And like as soon as the music started playing, I watched my friend's Adam, his ears just perk up, right? And he's just leaning in, watching this intently. And then the music, it's amazing. It was great to watch his experience. And then, you know, what was the other guy called? They pan over and they go, Bruce Willis goes, they called him Mr. Glass. And Adam literally loses his SH*T, jumps up, throws his hat down, excited. He's like loving it because he loves Unbreakable. He's like, oh my God. And we watched him just like somebody watching a David Blaine magic trick.
Yes.
Know, he just blew up like this and that. And I'm like, it was worth it just to see his reaction to it.
It was great. It was great, great, great. And what was fascinating is that I saw it with my brother and okay. So, in a perfect world, I would go in not even knowing that there was something to expect at the end, some kind of twist or whatever, right? But you see, M. Night Shyamalan is sort of his brand, so you're kind of on guard, right? Mm-hmm. They do a great job in this movie from beginning to end of setting up, you know, the emerging strangeness of this disassociative personality disorder. What is it? DID or identity disorder. But like, you spend the entire movie asking questions. And one of those very valid questions is, wow, this protagonist chick who we're rooting for to escape the situation, she clearly had an abusive childhood and she clearly was in a tough spot. You know, it seems like as the show got more and more supernatural-ish and it only nibbles at the edges and just gets weirder and weirder, and you start to think, well, I mean, this is a psychological thriller. It's not like he's actually going to have superpowers. And then as you see what looks like superpowers being demonstrated, then it just pushed me harder and harder to, okay, the big twist is that she's the 24th personality. This is all in her mind. She's the one that's broken and damaged. And then instead, the big screw you, the monstrous and genuinely surprising twist to me is, nope, the twist is there's literally no twist. Everything happened exactly the way you saw it. And I was like, wow, what a really great twist. The guy really did develop superpowers with his multiple personality. He really is a menace and he really is out there. And then, you know, just the little tip of the hat with the wink in the eye is the, also, by the way, same universe as Unbreakable.
It was Samuel Jackson showing up in, you know, Iron Man. That's what it was.
Yeah. Yes.
And it's that. That's like, yeah, no, there's more to come, folks. And that was the idea of like, guess what? This is a universe. And I was trying to figure out like, if I didn't know, would I figured it out or when would I have started to? And I think I'm such a big Unbreakable fan. And like the fact that the train accident and all that was such a major part of this of like, oh yeah, when my father died in the train accident.
I had a fleeting thought. When I forgot all about this. When the Horde walks onto that Amtrak train, there was like this fleeting like, oh, what if this destroyed the train with David Dunn in it or whatever? And then it just evaporated because that made no sense. It was like, you know, it's just a train. But instead, oh my God, you know what? I wonder how many parallels that had to have been intentional, that the train was his galvanizing moment. He went to get on the train to become the Beast.
Seen the movie poster lineup?
I have. I intentionally was not looking at a lot of them. Can we take a look at those? Because I was trying to be spoiler free. But I'll tell you this much: right up until the end, up until that moment when he's pulling the bars apart, about to get the girl. Oh my gosh! Look at that.
So the mirror. The mirror breaks. They both have a mirror break motif on the movies.
Oh, but they match.
Well,
no,
not
quite.
Two of them line up in a very
they will match when they released as a two DVD set, though. I guarantee you. But my point is
the idea the idea is that they kind of lead up to the idea that Kevin's father left on a train. And then he buys the flowers and leaves them as if it were his gravesite, you know? Yeah. So the idea that his father died on the train is now there.
Shoot. So that is on the idea is that his dad died on the same train as.
Yeah. No, his David dad. Dunn. Yeah. Wow. Mr. Glass made him and
he made
David
the Horde
Dunn.
As well.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. I didn't piece that
by
together.
Way of creating that train accident, which was the big revelation in Unbreakable, was that Mr. Glass was trying to pull forth into society these super creatures.
Did you guys catch some of the what I assume had to have been deliberately strange phrasing that the girls used with each other when they first wake up imprisoned? And there's this kind of odd consensus they're seeking where it's just like, hey, are you with it? Are you one of us or not? Like like, there were some seeds planted very, very early in the beginning of the movie that that really put me on guard, thinking, yeah, these girls might not be what they seem, which is what made it so profound when there was definitely that moment where, like, nope, everything is exactly what it looked like.
Mm-hmm.
Did you guys catch that?
My fear, if I heard people talking about, like, oh, a twist, there was a and the name escapes me right now. There was a movie about, like, these people trapped in this diner or this restaurant trying to get out in a snowstorm, and it all turned out that it's, like, in the mind of this one schizophrenic guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so – and it was a good movie, but I was so afraid.
Is that 13?
Or that, Shutter Island or Room, Identity
Room 13
or
something? No, it's John Cusack.
Yeah.
I think that was Identity. Yeah.
Is that what?
Maybe Identity.
Identity.
Is that Identity? Oh, okay.
If I'm remembering.
Yeah, and I thought, like, I didn't think Shutter Island was a very satisfying movie at all, because you're kind of like, oh, this is all we have. It's unreliable narrator. He's probably nuts. You know, whatever. It wasn't as fulfilling, but yeah, I thought Identity, I thought was a solid, but I was just afraid it was like, all right, well, what's the Shyamalan twist going to be on that? But instead, you know, like Brian, as you pointed out, you know, it wasn't. Hey, it's all in your head. It's like, no, it's not in your head. And it's even more, you know, visceral than that, which I really, really dug. I thought some of the writing was ham-fisted, you know, like, oh, that you can climb up walls by surface tension. And we get this explanation. And then when James McAvoy's running and the two security guards are like, was that some kind of animal? I'm like, no, it's Professor X.
Oh, no. It was, don't worry. It's just an animal. They're sure that it's an animal that's running by in his underwear.
Well, and it was very oddly specific when the psychologist is just like, I know, I've heard you talk about this mysterious beast that's super strong and can stop bullets and climb walls, but that's just a fantasy. That can't possibly happen.
Yeah. There are some moments, a few moments like that, and then, you know, and then that the two women watching The Price is Right. Right. And you're like, well, he put her, that older woman, there, so there'd be a worse actor than him.
you've got to spin the wheel this way.
Yeah.
But they do a good job of not making it so disjointed that you get annoyed, but disjointed enough that you just don't know what the pieces are you're looking at. Right. And that they really do all kind of connect right at the end.
It's schlock, and I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean that in a very, very fun way. It's James McAvoy doing big, silly voices and characters, some of them better than others. And the fact that there is some crappy acting and there's some dialogue that's like just kind of a gigantic neon sign for things that it's going to want permission for later in the movie is fine, because I think it has that general tone. And I think it was refreshing to me, because I think it's M. Night Shyamalan indulging some of the elements that I liked about him when I liked his movies more, which is, hey, wouldn't this be cool, as opposed to, aren't I clever?
So the question, would you guys had the experience of knowing what it was going into it. I did not. And there was that brief moment before that ending twist where I thought, they were right. I'm glad I saw this not knowing anything. Really good movie. That was really fun. I was left guessing all the way till the end. And then obviously, you know, that transformative, like, no, Unbreakable was a hero's origin story. This is a supervillain's origin story. That was fantastic. But I thought I assume I would still like it just as much had I not seen that end. Do you guys feel like, how necessary was that end to you guys liking it?
It's what got
me into the theater.
Well, yeah. Yes, but that is not the defining characteristic of how good a movie is what gets you into the theater.
It made me grade it on a curve, because it made me forgive some of the sort of sillier sort of writing moments and stuff into it. And it also, the fact that I'd be sitting there going, all right, I guess it's a thing, you know, people dying in train accidents is part of what he does. I'd be like, why is he revisiting this? I would be a little bit confused. I know I would have left it a little confused as to why, you know, again, like I watched Unbreakable probably like 2 weeks before I knew this was even related to that. Cause I just said, it's a movie I got to go back and watch again. So, I don't know. I thought there were, parts of it that sort of drove me nuts was, like, you know, that, like, the abuse situation earlier where she's trying to use the shotgun and she finds herself again with the shotgun and now she has this, it was like too similar to the, well, conveniently enough, we got the same kind of gun right for you right now. That, and there was other parts that just kind of got to me a little, but there were other parts I thought were great, like the abduction part at the very beginning of the mall, you know, with, you know, I thought that was really great. You know, I'm like, McAvoy sits in the car and I'm like, man, Professor X has gotten very aggressive in his yeah. recruitment technique.
Hey, so this is interesting. You knew that that was ham-fisted direction because with the two shotgun scenes being just right there and being the exact same thing. I took that as evidence the entire time it's happening. I'm like, oh yeah, no, of course this is happening in her mind because this is exactly what happened before. Now she's just reliving mm-hmm. it in this different way. So that's interesting because I didn't, while it was happening, because I was suspecting that it was all in her mind, I did not perceive that as lazy storytelling. I thought mm-hmm. that was just, you know, a different story.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's probably the biggest difference is that based on the first trailer I saw for it, I assumed that this was a story where multiple personality disorder person gets superpowers. You know, because the first trailer was him, and even the poster, there's a poster for it that's like, you know, Kevin has personalities, yada, yada, yada. And like, it's a bunch of regular people and then one gigantic monster person or whatever. So that's what I assumed it was. So there was never really a moment. There were moments in the movie where I was like, wait a minute, is she, because we hear at the beginning, oh, she runs away a lot, yada, yada, yada. Like, and based on the beginning where she hesitates, I didn't know whether or not she was a part, not physically like in the mind of anybody, but if she was in cahoots with Kevin or one of his personalities, then that was going to be a revelation. But I never assumed that they were all together. Although at the same time, Andrew and I had conversations where we were relieved that that was not the case. So that, you know, in all fairness, might have colored my thoughts on it. But from the trailer, I did not think that this was going to be an all in the mind kind of thing.
I would say that, and part of, I know I would have probably judged, I'd be still thinking more about McAvoy's characters because, like, the characters were, there were like, it felt like there were three characters and we're told they're 24 and the kid, like, doing, like, acting, trying to portray a child is very hard. And he portrayed a child. It seemed to me like exactly like what somebody would do. If we randomly pointed, you pretend you're a kid, it would be that, which I was kind of in the middle of. I'm kind of going, is this intentionally a bad impersonation of a kid to let us know that it's not really, you know, a real condition?
Could they not clear Kanye West in that scene where he's like, I listen to Kanye West, and then she's like, oh, play more Kanye West. And then when he's playing the song and dancing, they can't play Kanye West.
I was just like, man, I would have thought they'd use a more recognizably Kanye West song than this.
So. I was just wondering what Kanye West song that dance obviously syncs up to.
Right.
Hey, I do want to say real quick, I thought that opening scene was electric, and I realized part of the reason it was so electric is because it reminded me so much of my pick. My pick is Utopia. Is it Channel 4 production? It's great. It's good. You should watch it. It's gorgeous and haunting. And I've only watched the first season of it. Second season, I'm told it was good, but got canceled. But the first 10 minutes of Utopia will positively electrify you. And much like the beginning of this thing is.
My pick is going to be my new favorite YouTube movie critic, Jenny Nichols, who released a video this week about the problems with character motivations for the main character of this movie, Split, as well as Finding Dory. I think we sit.
That came out. I haven't watched it yet. I'm glad I can now watch that.
Yeah, my biggest issue with Split in general was some of the motivation of the main character. I felt that I'll just say this: the strongest female character in Split is played by James McAvoy. I really like the video, like I like all of her videos. So go ahead and check it out.
She's fantastic. Every time I watch her, she's just funny, on point, and does great stuff. I'm just going to rest on your picks. I'm gonna say what they said.
You know what? I'm going to grab your picks, throw them on the ground, and insist you get Illusion XX, the new book containing all of Andrew Vane's stuff.
Oh, boy. Thank you very much. I even uploaded a video about it.
Oh, yeah. By the way, you did like a 30-minute talk through of it. At first, I thought it was just going to be a trailer, and then you just were talking. I'm like, oh, my God, this is like you gave a lecture of all the stuff in the book.
Yeah, and I asked for questions about illusions and magic, and I answered those too. And so it was like what went, because every book that I wrote on illusions sort of had an approach. The first book, Solo X, was one man illusions, right? Like how you would, you know, the approach towards that illusion effects was easy to build illusions. And then why I wrote each book, what went in, you know, what was it? And then if you're into magic or whatever, it might be kind of informative towards you. And then I answered some questions people had asked me about illusions. So,
hey, was, all right. Everybody go buy Illusion XX. And also there's another big deal with all the DVDs, right?
Yeah, I do a combo pack where you get Illusion Double X and then you can get all six of my Illusion DVDs for it's a lot. I mean, it's the book is right now it's discounted just to $80. I'm selling as the pre-sale. It ships like on the 28th, but it's doing a pre-sale on it, and it's a lot. But I mean but for what you get is amazing. It's a huge book. You've seen, I don't know where it is right here. I've got it on a tray.
If you are into that kind of stuff and building stuff, then it is a no-brainer. All right,
yeah, over 600 pages of magic, so fun. Gentlemen, it's been after.
Hang on, I'm buying your book.
After, that's how I ended. I say it's been after.
It sure has.
I just thought it was weird that you just commented that it had been
my
after.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we hear you. Can you hear us?
We can hear your potty mouth.
You were paused for a little bit.
Oh, my God. Wait. All right. So, listen. I was. I called Andrew about this right after I got out of the movie. What if girl's got her shotgun on James McAvoy? He's advancing on her. She's got to make a decision. All of a sudden, she starts twitching, shaking, and she's like, oh, shit. Now she's got her own split personality, and this one's an Italian marksman. And she's like, hey, I'm an Italian marksman, and now I can shoot at a gun well. Papa, papa. And it's like, oh, wait, she's got to escape now. It's like, oh, now I'm a Japanese ninja. I go flip a flip. I get away because I am a Japanese ninja now.
And then it turns into Journey Quest. Just always another personality around the corner.
I wanted everybody to start having a million different personalities. And then the old woman's like, and now I can heal.
The old woman stands up. We're like, what? I thought you were dead. We're like, that was my other personality.
Oh,
dead
that
lady.
That was Dolores. I'm Carol. Kuwait and Luke, I lean on accent work. All right, no, we'll go watch that movie. That movie leans on accent work, and the three, you know, Jesus, talk about every piece of the buffalo for James McAvoy's female accent.
His range,
like, oh no, yeah, I do.
I thought he did all right. I thought he was a fine and chilling transformation at times.
I didn't find his British accent very believable.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, what a schlock.
By the way, what's with the one personality that just is constantly giving a lecture on Muslim wars of
I mean, come
a thousand
on,
years
come
ago?
On. And then it's just like oh no, like oh this is the woman and this is the gay guy, and let's just like not pay attention to the fact that they're kind of the exact same voice.
Right. One wears a turtleneck.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Don't worry. I won't let them hurt you.
All righty. Well, Justin, you got to get to Hotline Monday, don't you?
I do.
Yeah, good job, team.
All right.
Bye-bye. We love
you. See you guys later for Court Killers, too.